I want to thank everyone for showing up tonight. I've got 7:03. We will get started. We will start with the Pledge of Allegiance. So please join me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, good evening, folks. Thank you for showing up. We've started a new practice, at least at the county commission level, and that is if you are speaking, we invite you to take your mask off, because I've had some feedback from the public about not being able to hear what people are saying. I think we're all appropriately socially distanced from each other, so that the speaker can take their mask off. But if you're not speaking, just put it back on. If somebody is not comfortable with that, just let me know privately or off to the side, and we can adjust accordingly. But we've had some comments from the public about being able to speak in the microphone in here. So with that said, I think first on our agenda there is opening introductions. And I just want to take the opportunity again to repeat or maybe refine what our mission statement is here. I had one of the members of the committee after the last meeting took the opportunity to send me a message and just ask me, what is the mission of this committee? Exactly what are we doing here? And I wanted to roll that around in my head for a while and take a look at it, and I've been out of the office for a while too. So I did some research with other county commissions around the country who have embarked on the very same process that we're doing here, and I discovered a couple things. First of all, we're pretty much doing the same thing that they've done in terms of a process or procedurally. So I think we kind of fit into the mainstream of how we're endeavoring to figure out what we need to do here with regard to our courthouse. But I did find a mission statement for this kind of committee that I wanted to introduce to everyone. And it says the following: is the current courthouse facility the best or even a viable long-term solution for the administration of justice and the administration of county activities in Lincoln County? That was the first question. And then the second question posed is, if a different facility is needed, are you ready now to engage in a planning process that will result in a formal proposal to the citizens for ultimate decision? And I think we've engaged in prong number two, and I'd say with regard to question number one, that's the question we're trying to answer here. And I'll pass this around if anybody wants to see it. But, you know, just to restate, is the current courthouse facility the best or even a viable long-term solution for the administration of justice and the administration of county activities in Lincoln County? Sounds simplistic, I know, but did some research in other counties, and this is what I could find. So to answer that person's question about what the mission statement is for this committee, that's what I would put forward to you. And so that's my opening statement, and I've got co-chairman Commissioner Schmidt here with us, and if he'd like to say anything, I'll hand it over to him.
Strange as it may seem, Commissioner, I have nothing to add.
I'm shocked and speechless. Shocked. Okay, so presentation by UJS, our Unified Judicial System. We are blessed to have the participation of two circuit court judges on our committee. The presiding judge, Judge Howman, is with us, and then we also have participation from Circuit Court Judge Rasmussen as well. And what they're going to do tonight is give a presentation on the needs, desires, wishes of the court system here in Lincoln County. And with that, I'll hand it over to them.
All right. Thank you very much. Again, my name is Robin Hellman. I'm the presiding judge of the Second Judicial Circuit. It's easier for me to stand and talk than it is to sit and talk, so my apologies to those of you who are to my side and to the public who is to my back. My apologies for that. I also decided that I was going to be warm tonight as opposed to looking like a judge, so I apologize for not being here in a dress, which I normally would be. Let's see, I'm gonna need a little bit of, did I exit myself out of what I was supposed to be in? Sorry, I wanna make sure I know how to operate moving forward.
That one's all right.
Ah, there we go, great. Okay, so I thought I would start out tonight. My mission is to identify and to explain to you the future needs of the court system here in Lincoln County. And we use the term a court system, and I think sometimes people are confused. So I was going to start out tonight and identify the different types of court systems that we have in South Dakota so you understand exactly what it is we're looking at here in Lincoln County and the court system that occupies this space. There are essentially two classifications of courts in the state of South Dakota. There are federal courts and there are state courts. Federal courts are those that hear cases involving federal questions or cases where there is a diversity of citizenship and a dollar threshold limit that is met in those cases. And federal cases can be criminal cases, they can be civil cases, or federal bankruptcy cases. And I've just listed here for you the federal judges that we have in the state of South Dakota along with the magistrate judges and identified what those circuits are. Then we also have state courts, and there are three levels of state courts within the state of South Dakota. It's the South Dakota Supreme Court, our circuit courts, and magistrate courts. It's the South Dakota Supreme Court is the highest court in our state as far as state courts. We have five justices on the state court. And South Dakota is a little bit unique as opposed to other states. We have appeals by right. That means anybody who believes that their case should be appealed, almost no matter what the case is, has the opportunity to appeal that case to the South Dakota Supreme Court and have a decision raised. Then we have what are called our circuit courts, and the circuit courts are made up of circuit courts themselves and magistrate courts. Within the state of South Dakota, we have seven separate circuits that are divided amongst our counties, and we have 45 circuit court judges within the state and 16 magistrate judges in the state. Our circuit courts are courts of general jurisdiction. What that means is they hear all felony level criminal cases. They hear civil cases. Those would be things like medical malpractice, contract disputes, car accidents, things of that nature. They also hear things such as guardianships, conservatorships, when somebody's looking for a protection order, or probates, if somebody has died or there's a will or an estate to submit to probate. Circuit courts also hear family law cases. Those would be divorces or child custody matters. And they also take appeals from magistrate court cases. Then we have our third layer of courts in the state of South Dakota, and that's our magistrate courts. Those are what we call courts of limited jurisdictions. They hear small claims cases, which are cases where the matter in controversy is less than $12,000. Also civil cases, let's say it was a car accident, they could hear it if the claim for damages was under $12,000. They also hear misdemeanors, those are class one or class two misdemeanor criminal cases, as well as traffic tickets. So that just gives you a brief overview of the types of courts that we have within our state, the three levels of our state courts, and then the two levels that are combined within this courthouse, and that would be our circuit court and our magistrate courts. So I mentioned that we have seven circuits within the state, and Lincoln County is comprised or held within the second judicial circuit in our state. And the second circuit is Minnehaha and Lincoln County. Within this particular circuit, we have 12 circuit court judges and 4 magistrates that are assigned to hear all of the cases within Minnehaha County and Lincoln County. I've also listed for you here the dates of appointment to the 12 circuit court judges, and then our 4 magistrate judges, you have their names as well. And those individuals are actually employees of the court system. They're a little bit dissimilar to circuit court judges who are appointed either by the governor or elected by the citizens within our counties. Now, as I mentioned, there's 7 circuits within the state, and of course, because of our size here in Minnehaha and Lincoln County, we do things a little bit differently than the rest of the circuits do within the state of South Dakota. In Rapid City or other jurisdictions within the state, each judge who is a circuit court judge hears all types of cases, whether it's criminal cases, family law cases, probates. Those judges in other circuits, they hear all of those cases. In the Second Circuit, we have a need for efficiency, which I'll explain to you why that is in a little bit, but we need to be a little bit more efficient, and we decided about 20 years ago that the way we could be more efficient is if we conquered and divided our duties. So for a long number of years, we have particularly assigned judges to particular sections of that general jurisdiction duty. And then every 12 or 18 months or 2 years, we rotate. So what that looks like practically in Sioux Falls and Minnehaha County is that we have 4.5 judges who hear all felony criminal matters in Minnehaha County. We have 4.5 judges in Minnehaha County who hear all of the civil matters, and that would include civil cases, probates, guardianships, and all family law cases. We have 1 judge who hears exclusively all felony criminal matters in Lincoln County, and that's Judge Rasmussen. And we have 1/2 a judge in Sioux Falls who hears all of the civil cases in Lincoln County. Then we have a judge who hears all of the juvenile cases, so matters involving juveniles. That judge hears all of those cases in Minnehaha and Lincoln County. And then we have a judge who hears exclusively all of our abuse and neglect cases. Those are cases where the Department of Social Services, for one reason, has identified that children need to be removed from the home. And so we have that one judge who hears that specialty group of cases in Minnehaha and in Lincoln County. And then I mentioned these 4 magistrate judges. They hear all of the magistrate cases in Minnehaha County, but they also travel here to Lincoln County 1 day a week and hear magistrate cases here within the county. That's not enough time for them to hear all of them, but they do a substantial portion of the magistrate work here, and generally that's our criminal magistrate work. We're also always constantly shifting these resources to make sure that we're covering all of the cases that we have and that it just makes sense to handle them that way. Now, you might be wondering, why is the county at all involved in what our state courts do? And that is because of some statutes that have been passed by our legislature that essentially require that counties provide these court facilities for magistrates and for circuit court work, as well as for jurors. We won't go through them, but I listed them here. They're also in your packet if you have any desire to read these statutes. Now, it's going to be no surprise to all of you, certainly not a surprise to us, that Lincoln County is one of the fastest growing counties in the nation, actually. Based upon this census estimate, it's the 13th fastest growing county in the country. One chart that I saw projected that Lincoln County's population will be 87,910 by the year 2035. And that comes from SDSU's Demographic Center. That's up from a 2020 population of 62,170. So that means over the next 15 years, the population of Lincoln County is expected to grow almost 26,000. And you can also see that in your Lincoln County budget. Some figures that I looked at were back in 2000, you had a $7 million budget for the county, and in 2016, it was a $27 million budget. So not only by people, but your budget is growing as well in Lincoln County. If we look at some narrower sources, such as the Harrisburg School District, this is a chart that I have of district enrollment from the year of 2000 up to 2019. And if you look, particularly since about 2010, just the Harrisburg School District on its own has grown about 300 students per year. So the growth that we're seeing in Lincoln County is really tremendous. We also see that in our long-term employment numbers. In the year 2010, it looks to me like this graph shows that there's about 12,000 individuals employed from the county. That figure doubled in 9 years to 2019 of 24,000 people. So I think what these figures show is that from all measures, all sectors of growth, Lincoln County is booming. And the county needs to meet that growth, and the court system needs to as well. That growth we've also seen in our statewide court size rankings. Back in 2011, you can see this first chart shows you that Lincoln County is the ninth largest county in the state as far as case filings. By 2018, Lincoln County was the fourth largest county. 2019, it was the third largest county as far as case filings. And again in 2020, it retained that position of the third largest county as far as case court filings are concerned. Now, when we look at this figure for 2020, the unified judicial system goes from a July 1 to June 30th to determine our fiscal year. So fiscal year 2020 includes 4 months of COVID. Even with COVID, the figures that you see from 2019 to 2020, Lincoln County case filings grew by 400. Every other county in the state had their case filings decline over that year period. So Lincoln County grew by case filings even during COVID. And those case filings, we see those growing in virtually every segment of the type of cases that we hear in Lincoln County. Those include criminal cases and civil cases, as well as criminal and traffic cases, and small claims and civil cases. The total percentage increase over 2013 to 2020 is 57% growth in our case filings within the county of Lincoln. Now you do see that there's just a slight blip down in fiscal year 19. The only thing that we can account for that dip, and we saw the same dip in Sioux Falls, is that there were fewer traffic citations issued by law enforcement. So for those of you who may be accustomed to getting those traffic citations, you've got a little bit of a break. Those traffic citations are actually something that really have no impact on the actual operation or our workload within circuits, but it does account for any dip that you might see in the case numbers. So if we look particularly at felony case filings, this is really where we've seen tremendous growth within Lincoln County. Lincoln County felonies have been up 226% in the last 11 years. Particularly since 2016, you have seen those numbers actually explode. And they're exploding pre-COVID about 70 cases per year, which sounds small, but it's actually a lot of work for everybody, and that's accounts for a lot of growth that the court system has seen. And in case you're wondering where all this crime is occurring, the crime in Lincoln County is occurring north of 276th Street. We did just a brief sample. We took a random sample of 100 criminal cases based on the location of arrest that were filed within the year 2020 and pinpointed the location of that arrest. And you can see that the vast majority of those cases are north of that 276th Street. You can actually see 100 little dots on that chart because many of them are overlapping, but it does give you an indication of where all of that crime is occurring. And again, as I mentioned a little bit ago, the case numbers aren't increasing just in criminal cases, but they're increasing across all of the types of cases that we see within Lincoln County. And so I'm just going to highlight a couple of those examples. One of those is in our mental illness related case filings. Those case filings have increased 530% since fiscal year 207. Since fiscal year 2007. And we can probably understand that a lot of that has come since Avera Behavioral Health was located in Lincoln County back in 2006. That's the year it opened, and it's the only multi-specialty hospital within 200 miles of Sioux Falls. It has 110 beds for inpatient and outpatient services. Although we don't have any direct data, I believe that a vast majority of that increase in the mental illness filings that we have is directly correlated to the increase in criminal cases, because a lot of people who suffer from mental illness also have co-occurring substance use disorders. Now, when we look at the little dip that we have in the chart, the tornado occurred in September of 2019, and so the facility didn't reopen until June of 2020. So it's a little bit hard for us to predict what those numbers are moving forward based on that dip, but we're still looking at probably an average increase of about 60 cases per year just in the area of mental illness. And I thought it would also be important to give you a bit of perspective about what the mental illness cases look like in Lincoln County as compared to other counties. What you see in blue is the First Circuit, and that's the circuit that encompasses Yankton. So you would imagine that Yankton would have a lot of mental illness filings because of the Human Services Center in Yankton. The red portion is the Second Circuit, so Minnehaha and Lincoln County. So we see 47% of the mental illness cases in the state. The First Circuit sees 34% of those. Directly, the 578 cases that we see in Lincoln County are more cases than the Third Circuit, the Fourth Circuit, the Fifth Circuit, the Sixth Circuit, and the Seventh Circuit all see. So just in Lincoln County, they have more mental illness cases than the vast majority of the circuits. And those circuits encompass sometimes 12 or 13 different counties. So the mental illness cases that we have in Lincoln County are a little bit staggering when compared to other areas of the state. We've also seen a huge increase in our small claims filings. That's a 77% increase from fiscal year 2013 to fiscal year 2020. We see the huge growth between the years of 2015 and 2017, and we averaged the increase in those cases to be between 50 and 60 additional small claims cases filed each year. Now, here's where you might get a little disgusted and a little bit frustrated, and where I explain some discrepancies about growth within our state court system. You see on this chart, the Second Circuit again is in red, Minnehaha and Lincoln County. We hear 35% of the cases that are filed within the state of South Dakota. On a yearly basis, cases filed in fiscal year 2020, that was 65,411 cases. Statewide, there's 188,130 cases filed. While the Second Circuit hears 35% of the cases in the state, we receive only 23% of the state's circuit court budget. While we handle 35% of the cases in the state, we only have 25% of the resources for personnel within the state of South Dakota. You may be wondering, how is that possible? Well, I kind of wonder that too, and that's one of my goals over the next couple of years is to try and ensure that we have the amount of resources that we need, because these disparities are simply not sustainable long term. We can't be doing 35% of the work with 25% of the personnel or budgetary resources. And we've tried to acknowledge this discrepancy with our projections, still taking into account that because we're larger, we do have a certain amount of efficiency built into the way we do things. But even with those efficiencies, we can't be as efficient as the resources we have. We're struggling, we need additional resources, and I think our projections need to reflect that we do need those resources. So if we look at some sort of averages, the judges in the Second Circuit hear an average of 4,088 cases per year. And that's simply by taking that 65,411 figure and dividing by the number of judges that we have. The statewide average of cases heard per judge is 2,989. So I didn't write that down, but that's a discrepancy of about 1,200 more cases that we hear in Minnehaha and Lincoln County than other circuits and other counties within the state. Based on those case filings of 65 plus 1,000, we would need 21.8 judges to hear the same number of average cases that other judges do within the state. Now again, we realize that we have some efficiencies built in. We really don't need 5.8 more judges to hear all of the cases that we do. And so what the UJS does is they do what's called a weighted workload study. They do that every year to determine what resources a particular county or a particular circuit needs based on their case filings. It goes really deep into the woods, and it's based on a number of factors. Here's one, for instance. Peer in Hughes County hears a lot of what we call administrative cases. Those are cases like you hear about in the news, whether or not Amendment A is constitutional. Those type of cases are really labor intensive, and they take a lot of time. So Hughes County gets a little bit of bump in that weighted caseload to account for the administrative cases that we have that they have. We really don't have those administrative cases. So these weighted workloads even go into the detail of what type of cases, what amount of time they take for a judge to hear over the course of the year, and then the study is published and it figures out what does this community, what does this county need as far as resources. So our weighted workload study for judge need in the Second Circuit for fiscal year 2020 says that we have a deficit, that we need 4.42 more judges in Minnehaha and Lincoln County that we do to do the work that we need. Now, if we had those 4.42 extra judges, my best guess on how that would divvy up between Lincoln and Minnehaha County would be that we'd have 4 magistrate judges full-time in Minnehaha County, 1 magistrate full-time in Lincoln County, about 13.2 circuit court judges in Minnehaha County, and about 2.22 circuit court judges in Lincoln County. Now you can see these numbers are highly fluid. It's a little bit hard to identify how you have 0.22% of a judge in one county versus another, but my best guess is if we had all of those resources, this is what it would look like. And Lincoln County would have full-time here about 3.22 judges. Now, I said that they do this weighted workload study. They also do it as far as clerks. Now, if we go back and look at the statewide cases per clerk, like we did judges, that's 65,411. We have 46 clerks within Minnehaha and Lincoln County. So based on that, they do an average of 1,422 cases per year. You can see that the other counties are far below those case numbers. We actually have 5 clerks here in Lincoln County. So the statewide average per clerk of cases per year is 914. The Second Circuit then, as a result, has 508 more cases per year per clerk than just the average across the state. And again, just like our judge need, these disparities just simply are not sustainable long time. I took the average number of cases per clerk and divided our caseload in the Second Circuit and decided if we were doing the same average number of cases that other jurisdictions were, we would need 71.5 clerks. You can see in the Second Circuit, we only have 46 for a deficit of 25.5. Now, if you look back, the fiscal year 2020, Lincoln County caseload was 8,676. You can see here that in Lincoln County, the clerks are doing far more cases per clerk than any other county, including Minnehaha County, about 350 cases more per clerk in Lincoln County than in Minnehaha County. So again, if we went by that average of 914 cases per clerk, Lincoln County would actually need 9.5 clerks right now just to do the average caseload. Again, we only have 5 clerks in Lincoln County. And we do again acknowledge that our weighted workload study says we're a little bit more efficient. So across our entire circuit, we're down about 10 more clerks. We could use 10 more clerks to do the work that we need to do. We've identified that the deficit then in Lincoln County is about 3.21 clerks. That makes the Minnehaha County deficit 6.63. Now, the last time Minnehaha and Lincoln County got additional clerk staff was back in 2013. Since that time, we've added 2 new circuit court judges to this circuit. And our clerks are really those who do the day in, the day out work. They're responsible for processing, reviewing, entering, and maintaining every court case file that's filed in a particular county. They catalog, preserve, retrieve all hearing and trial exhibits for every case. They clerk hundreds of hearings each month. That's sitting in the courtroom with the judge, entering that information into our computer system to make sure that we have a near real-time update of what's going on, particularly in criminal cases, because that allows the jail to be releasing those people or bonds to be imposed. So having that real-time information is very important. They also prepare and distribute forms, judgments, notices, and across the circuit, they answer about 1,200 phone calls per day. I don't know what the particular number is in Lincoln County, but 1,200 calls per day amongst these clerks is a lot. I can't even venture a guess at how many emails they get and respond to throughout the course of any given day. So you can see that although we have 5 clerks now here in Lincoln County, we should have about 8.5. So when I say there's disparities between what we have now and what we really need, this is something that I'd really like this committee to focus on, that the needs of this courthouse ought not be dependent on the resources that we have today, but should take into account the resources that we actually need. Because it's my great hope over the next couple of years, particularly with the budgets that we have in Pierre, that we'll be able to accommodate this growth and that our circuit will finally have the resources that we need to handle this tremendous caseload growth. Kind of the third prong of what we have within our court system, we have the judges, we have the clerks, and then we have court services officers. Just like we experienced with all of the other weighted workload studies, in the Second Circuit, we have a deficit of about 7.5 court services officers. Again, this is based on our 2020 workload study. And the number of adult probationers placed on probation since 2016 has increased by 26%. The number of juveniles on probation during that same time period has increased 50%. So again, when we don't have enough court services officers to supervise these cases, what it results in is our court services officers not doing the complete job that they ought to be doing, but they're simply doing triage work. Many of the people that they're working with, both adults and juveniles, have substance use disorders. They also have co-occurring mental health disorders. And on any given day, a court services officer might come to work and have appointments scheduled with 10 individuals, but the first person coming in, either hot for meth or in the midst of a crisis, is really going to take all of the attention of that court services officer pretty much for that entire day, trying to meet that client where they're at, trying to arrange for their immediate mental health or substance use needs. So when we say that we're down 7.5 court services officers, that would just be enough to get us by with those officers doing really the job that they're meant to be doing. So I guess what all this comes down to is a caseload and trend projection that we have for Lincoln County. Over the last number of years, all of the charts that I've shown you, we have estimated that our growth is somewhere between 7 and 8%. Prior to COVID, you can see that annual increase was 8.19%, average annual increase. We're looking at about 7.46% growth even during COVID in the year 2020. So we think projecting into the future a growth rate of 8% in our case filings each year is probably pretty reasonable, and it's probably pretty conservative. So this chart just shows you what we anticipate our case numbers to be and our needs in the future. So right now, what we would project those to be is based on our current weighted workload studies. I've placed the numbers that those workload studies say we ought to have. And on the first line, you can see the numbers that we actually have. So based on those, we've projected our growth to 5 years and to 10 years. And we're essentially doubling the number of people that we should have to what we think we will have in 10 years. Currently, it would be about 13.5 employees. 10 years from now, we anticipate there to be 25 court employees here in the Lincoln County Courthouse. So to summarize this, we've projected in consultation with Architects Inc., we figure that in 10 years, the projected need is 6 different courtrooms. That would include 2 jury trial courtrooms and 2 smaller non-jury courtrooms, as well as 2 smaller what we would call hearing rooms, where you don't anticipate a lot of public, where you don't anticipate a lot of parties. So we really tried to structure this to identify what the exact needs are. We certainly don't need 6 courtrooms that are prepared for jury trials, because we don't anticipate in the next long period of time that there would be any occasion where Lincoln County would have 6 jury trials going on at one time. So we really tried to identify the types of courtrooms that we would need to meet the needs of the counties. That would include 6 additional judges, or 6 separate judges chambers, plus space for a visiting judge. What we have frequently now in Lincoln County is in any given day, there could be up to 4 different judges here in Lincoln County hearing cases, be fill-in judges if we have more jury trials going. We have that juvenile judge who comes down. We have the abuse and neglect judge who comes down. And we also have that civil judge in addition to Judge Rasmussen. So there are occasions in our recent history where we've had 4 judges in the courthouse hearing cases here in Lincoln County during any given day. Due to COVID, we also have space constraints with our jury trials. And so next week, we actually have a Lincoln County jury trial that is scheduled to go to trial in the Minnehaha County Courthouse, because there isn't sufficient space to handle 2 jury trials in this courthouse at one time. We've also projected the office space for a little more than 5.5 probation officers. Now, the caveat here is that I want to explain, we did a count of probationers that are supervised in Minnehaha County. And currently we have 230 probationers on Lincoln County cases that are supervised from the Minnehaha County Courthouse. There are a number of reasons for this. Primarily, that is because somebody lives in Minnehaha County and they obtained a charge in Lincoln County. And to have that person come to Lincoln County to meet with their court services officer once a week, every other week, or once a month would be really prohibitive for that individual. Either they don't have transportation, or just looking at the time and commitment it would take to have somebody come down here to meet with their court services officer when they live and work in Sioux Falls, that would be perhaps 3 hours out of their day to meet with their court services officer for 45 minutes. So the 5.67 probation officer spaces is presuming that those individuals, those court services officers, would be located here in Lincoln County, and we would still be supervising a large number of people within Minnehaha County. Then I thought it would also be important, we were originally asked to look for 10-year projections. I thought if you're going to be building space, your time horizon is probably a little bit longer than 10 years, and we should look out to 20 years. But I missed this slide because this is really important, so let me follow up with this first. In addition to the judges, chambers, court services officers, and clerks, we also need a secure area for prisoner access and transport, as well as secure vehicle parking for the judges and some of the staff. We have many people who are taken into custody here in the courthouse during the course of any given day or any given week. Those individuals need to be secured, and then arrangements need to be made for their transport. There's also a great need for attorney-client conference rooms for each courtroom. Frequently, parties are attempting to settle cases. Attorneys need to talk to clients before they go into court. So it's vital that any court space have those attorney-client conference room as well. We also believe that there is a distinct need for a control room for electronic courtroom recording systems and that operator here in here in Lincoln County. Right now, the courtrooms here in Lincoln County are all controlled by a CourtSmart system, which digitally records the proceedings. We also physically have one court reporter who is housed here in the courthouse. But when you have multiple proceedings going on at any time during a day, one court reporter isn't sufficient, so we have these courtrooms electronically recorded. Now, the person who monitors those recordings right now is housed in Minnehaha County. And it doesn't make sense when you're recording up to 6 courtrooms to have somebody that far away. And actually, best practices would suggest that we should have one court recorder for every 2 courtrooms. We obviously don't believe that that is really necessary, and that's certainly not a practice we have in the Second Circuit. But we do need space within our court facility here in Lincoln County to house that court recorder as well. We also believe, because of the number of people, that we should have an IT support person here. We also need a jury assembly room / a multi-purpose room for either jury gatherings, for meetings, for things of that nature. That would include also space for our bailiffs who man our large criminal court days as well as our jury trials. And then we also need storage space long-term for paper files and particularly for our exhibits. All of our files are kept electronically now, but we still do have requirements that we keep paper for 30 days, and in some cases it's longer than that. And for things such as exhibits, we need to keep them for much longer periods of time. So we do need space for that. Now back up again to our 20-year projections. I think it's important to plan for the future. Again, we've anticipated that Lincoln County has about an 8% growth rate. You look at things such as the Harrisburg School District growing at 300 students per year. I think it's reasonable to look at those 20-year projections. And when we look at those 20-year projections, we anticipate that the Lincoln County Courthouse, for all of our needs, needs space for almost 34 individuals, which is about 3 times what we should have today. So that took a little bit longer than I anticipated. My apologies, but I thought if we were going to tell you we needed this, we should explain why. So with that, are there any questions? Did I just silence everybody?
Did you say that one of the jury trials is going to be taking place in Minnehaha County that should be taking place here?
Yes.
And I thought that was illegal.
It is not. We would have jurors from Lincoln County, and they would report to the Minnehaha County Courthouse, and Lincoln County would need to pay for their mileage and the expenses for lunch, things like that. But it is not illegal for that to happen. In fact, it happens not frequently, but it's certainly not rare. If we look to the other side of the state, the Custer County Courthouse has been deemed off limits by presiding Judge Fifley in the Second Circuit, said it's not suitable for courthouse needs, and so all of those proceedings are being held in Pennington County, and it's certainly in accordance with statute. It is. And that would be a whole nother 45-minute discussion. All right. Thank you all for your time.
That
is accurate. Yeah. And if we had the staff that we actually needed to meet our current caseload and needs, the space is certainly deficient as far as those needs.
Anybody have any more questions for the judge? Okay. Comprehensive briefing. Perfect.
Good. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Andrew, thanks for, or as I understand it, you've completed the needs assessment as it relates to UJS and the court system, correct? And that's the presentation you're going to make here?
Yeah, so I've got it listed as 95% complete.
Sure.
I was planning to put it into a more formal written report or executive summary. But I think the meetings with Judge Howman and Judge Rasmussen and Carl and others, I think that part of the effort's done. It would just be to, after tonight, to formalize that findings into a report.
Very well. Thank you.
So good evening, everyone. I'm Andrew Etram with Architecture Incorporated. What I will be doing this evening is, last time we discussed the process that we've been going through, so I was going to give a quick update on that. We have, since the last public meeting, started to do the same space needs assessment for the county administration spaces as well. So I have preliminary numbers for that effort that I was going to share, just because it gives a whole picture or more complete picture of the whole facility here, and then review the results of the courthouse building and the courts systems space needs assessment, which I just referenced is basically 95% complete. So this all started last fall when we did an exterior assessment. We were then hired by the county to do the space needs assessment for the courthouse building or the courts system. And then since then, also hired to do the same space needs assessment for the administration building. And like I said, that's in progress. So through this process then, we have worked with John and the judges and all of the department heads here at Lincoln County and created this existing building or set of existing building plans that basically categorizes all of the spaces within the structure here that we're in. So here's the basement, first floor, second floor, and third floor of the existing spaces. So we have, we've then taken that information and quantified the existing square footage that both the court system and the administrative side, what they currently occupy. So we have a baseline understanding of what's the current space that's used for those different groups. So here's the the kind of preliminary results of the administration space needs assessment. So we're going to talk tonight, just to reiterate, and we discussed this last time, we're talking everything in net square feet. So we aren't factoring in corridors and other things. We're looking at the usable square footage, but inside the walls, you know, so it doesn't account for the restrooms, the corridors, the wall thickness, those types of things. We're just talking about net usable square footage. So on the admin side, there's about 37,000, just shy of 37,200 net square feet. And right now, through having meetings with all of the department heads and starting to lay out how those space needs that they've described to us, how those translate to square footage, we're at about 8,000 net square feet of additional space needs for the functions that basically happen in this building. So we will continue. We had our first round of meetings with all the department heads. We have started to then quantify those. That's where I was confident in giving that round 8,000 square foot number. The next effort to finish this assessment for the admin side is to come back out and show them individually, here's how we programmed the growth for your space based on what you told us in the meetings, and then we'll finalize that number. So the rest of the presentation this evening is based on then the courthouse, or the court system's space needs assessment. The last time we talked, we said there were both functional deficiencies, safety, security, technology, acoustics, adjacencies, et cetera, and then space deficiencies, and that's what we're going to focus on primarily tonight. So setting the stage here again for the existing conditions, the current courts system occupies 12,475, again, that's net square feet. So if we counted all of the square footage that they occupy, both courtroom 2B in this structure and then the spaces in the original courthouse structure, it's 12,475 square feet. So that's the three courtrooms and the support spaces, that's clerk of courts, that's court services, public defenders, et cetera. And like that last note says, it's about 3,100 square feet are in the administration building. That's the courtroom 2B and the support spaces. So basically, we worked with Carl and Judge Howman and Judge Rasmussen and others to get this input and took all of the statistics and the data and the projected growth for staff and courtrooms and tried to then take that and assign square foot numbers to it. And so what I will describe here over the next few slides is the summary of those efforts. So existing courtrooms, two large and one small, really the existing needs, which would be today if they could have it, would be to have two large, one medium, and two small. All of those would have judges' chambers, court reporter space, jury deliberation, attorney-client meeting rooms, et cetera, all of the support spaces to go along with that. So currently just the courtrooms and the support spaces are 8,285 square feet. If we were to meet the needs today with the two large, one medium, and two small courtrooms as described above, we would see that at just shy of 16,000 square feet. So about 7,700 square feet of additional space, almost doubling. And then that 10-year growth, which Judge Howman described of needing that sixth courtroom, that would grow that number to just shy of 20,000 square feet for the courtrooms and support spaces. Any questions on these numbers? And we can obviously come back to them. So this is the largest, obviously, this is the largest component of the court system is the actual courtrooms themselves and support spaces. So this is the bulk of the growth that we're projecting, but there's obviously growth in other areas. So clerk of courts, current staff of six, really current need, or current staff of five, excuse me, current need of six, as Judge Hallman presented, future growth of 10 to 13 total staff, not growth of that number, in the 5 to 10 year period. There's an existing of 2,361 square feet. We had that increase to just shy of 3,000, so 400, 500 square feet of extra space. Part of that is when we analyzed or looked at the square footage or the functionality of the layout of the existing square footage, we think there could be efficiencies gained if they were in new square footage, and that's why that growth is maybe less than you would assume for double plus the number of staff. Court services, same thing, current staff of three, future growth to five in 10 years. There's a little over 1,000 square feet now, and we have that 10-year growth number at 1,640, so just shy of 600 square feet of additional space. Sheriff and security, so really there aren't existing spaces specifically for the sheriff or for security purposes to support the court system. So Sally Port and the secured indoor parking spaces, the holding cell or the holding rooms, et cetera, all those things that were discussed. And so we're saying existing really is none. And what we've programmed is around 5,700 square feet. So obviously that's all a net add. So again, the existing total square footage used by the court system is 12,475. Courtrooms and support spaces. Now this is the 10-year growth number. So this is the six courtrooms that I plugged in here. So that's 11,635. Clerk of courts, court services, and then the sheriff and security of 5,700. We've currently are showing the total additional space needs of the court system as 18,364 net square feet. Any questions? This is 10 years, correct. Yeah, on the previous slide where we looked at courtrooms and support spaces, we're saying really today they could use the 7,700 square feet of additional. The number that I plugged in on that summary slide is based on that 19,900 number. So that's the difference of 11,635.
So we're actually 7,000 square feet.
If you looked at, so what we ended up doing is the spreadsheet document that we prepared had four columns to it. We had existing, current, existing needs, 5-year growth and 10-year growth. And so based on the data that was plugged in, there were marginal changes on that 5-year growth, mostly because if we would get the spaces up to what the current needs are, that would satisfy 5 years of growth, and then there was additional changes at that 10-year number. Make sense? So the last thing to think about or understand here is if we take that 12,475 plus the 18,364, basically 10 years from now, the courts would occupy just shy of 31,000 square feet. So 2.5 times what they occupy now.
what is the total existing square footage, net square footage, that we have available to us today?
You know, for
the entire courthouse combined.
We had those numbers in. So that total number is 83,000 square feet of building space. That would be this structure, basement first and second, plus the original building, basement through third.
Okay.
Was your question? That answered your
question? Yeah, and I don't want to play hide the ball, so I'll just fast forward to where I'm getting here. We've got needs. We've got what our needs are, what we're going to have to do, and then we've got what our existing is. Can you take what our needs are and fit that into our existing footprint when you convert it to be apples to apples, that net square footage calculation you use? Can you fit it into our existing, you know, building footprint that, or maybe I'm not using the correct terminology, but can you fit it into our existing building space or not?
I think the short answer is no, because there's no shell space or unused square footage in the building.
Okay. Give me the longer answer, though.
Well, the long answer is also no.
I agree. I think for the purposes of explaining to the public,
the building is, back to the existing plans. There isn't a square foot on this building, either the new piece that we're occupying or that we're in now, or the original courthouse structure, that isn't utilized. And so between courts and admin, we're talking about in 10 years, the need for 25,000 net square feet. So what we use as a rule of thumb to convert net to gross, so to factor wall thickness, corridors, mechanical space, restrooms, et cetera, is right around a 30% multiplier. So we would take that 25,000 times 30%, and that's the actual size of structure we need. So, you know, 25,000 times 30% is another 7,500 square feet. So really we're talking about gross square footage, 32,000+ square feet deficient in 10 years.
And you can't economize. You know, someone, for example, may say, well, do you really need a courtroom as big as what you estimated those two big courtrooms should be? Can we shave off 1,000 square feet? And maybe this is a question for the judges as well. That's why when I say, can you get into the weeds a little bit, you know, for example, how did you come up with needing that much square footage? I think the general public, when they hear this, they kind of say, well, okay, but I want to peek behind the curtain here. How did you come up with, why is a big courtroom the amount of square footage that you say it is? You know, can you maybe give us a deep dive into some of that?
So
he wants to say,
right,
yeah.
We had a real good example the other day, which is we had magistrate court. We had 115 files. And so Judge Rasmussen was nice enough to go for the magistrate judges and open up a second courtroom so they could get through it in the morning. So those big courtrooms sometimes isn't for trial. Sometimes we have magistrate court and you have 100 to 150 people coming in. And so that's one courtroom. So if you have a small courtroom, you can't do magistrate court. The old courthouse, and Judge Rasmussen remembers these days, used to go into the main courtroom, and then everybody would stand in the hallways because there wasn't enough room because there would be 75 to 80 people there for court. And so before the remodel was, you stood in the hallway, you talked to your clients, and if you're trying a case, your witnesses were all out there. So it isn't always the trial. just for the day-to-day hearings. I mean, I think circuit court has gotten to the point where there'll be 40 or 50 people come through. Well, you have to have accommodations to fit those people who are waiting for court, because they'll come in at 9 o'clock in the morning, and then they have to sit there until 11 o'clock in the morning for the case to be approved. So those are the type of things we're talking about. It's not a jury trial that really holds a lot of it up sometimes. It's just flat out, when you're doing juvenile court, you come down here on Tuesdays?
Wednesday afternoon.
Wednesday afternoon. If you want to know who's in juvenile court, which you're not supposed to know because it's confidential, you just go up to courtroom 2B and look in the hallway, because they're all sitting out in the hallway. They're all sitting on benches for everybody to walk through and see the kids who have underage consumptions or simple assaults or possibly charged with worse. And so they're sitting in the hallways. They don't have a place to be. So those are the type of things that when you talk about the bigger courtrooms, it's just so the public have a place to sit down and wait for their turn to come up to the bench. And we don't have that.
The other thing I would add to that as well is before we stopped transporting, pre-COVID, we would have, 20 inmates sometimes sitting in the courtroom with the public. We also need a big enough room that we can separate, since we don't have an in-custody space here, and transport them down. We need the inmates to be far enough from the general public to separate those two. Oftentimes we'll have victim and offender or relatives or people who are trying to communicate or pass messages, and we need enough space to make sure there's more than just a normal alleyway between that large of a group of inmates and the public.
So the other thing we did, Commissioner Aarons, is our firm also did the Minnehaha County Courthouse building. And so obviously Judge Rasmussen and Judge Howman and Carl are familiar with that facility. So when we were looking at what should we reasonably plug in for square footage for a small or a medium or a large, we were using the current spaces as a benchmark, but also spaces in Minnehaha County. So we did that for judges' chambers and jury deliberation rooms and all of the spaces that we analyzed.
Yeah, and you know, fortunately, a lot of the general public never has to go into a courtroom. They don't have to go into the judges' offices. You know, the judges are spending immense amount of time. They have a number of meetings in their offices. They need a conference room table space in there. There's just so the public knows, so our citizen members know, and I know the judges could speak to this. I guess I'll bring it up for them, though, because they probably don't want to sit here hat in hand asking for these things, is there's just a number of functions that drive the square footage necessity. It's not because they want a large office. It's just by the fact of necessity. There's a number of functions that go on in their offices throughout the day. For example, a settlement conference they may hold or something like that, that drives that square footage space. I think one of the things maybe we could think about doing is coordinating with the Minnehaha County Commission and with the judges here, take a look at the Sioux Falls courtroom space. And you can go up there and, you know, the general, you know, members of our panel here could go look and see what an actual courtroom space looks like. And, you know, I think they're appropriate. They're not these large, grand federal courtrooms. They are state circuit courtrooms that are used and trafficked pretty heavily with people coming in and out every day. As a practitioner, I appreciate the fact that they've said they need attorney-client courtroom space in there. Those are heavily used spaces, just so people know. We're not I don't think they're asking for those things because they're nice to have. You want, you know, to be able to talk to your attorney privately before your case starts. And actually, I think those spaces actually help drive settlement to a certain extent. Because there's a lot of heated, pressured conversations you have with your clients right before you're ready to go in and talk to the judge. And so I think the larger point here is I don't think anybody any of these requests that they've made are luxuries, but I think they're more necessities. Is that how you would categorize it?
Necessities or just common standard sizing of spaces for the function.
Okay.
And if I may, one of the things that I would add too is I'm certainly not here saying that the Minnehaha County Courthouse is the end all, be all. I wasn't involved in the design of the original structure or of the addition. So when we looked at what type of space was reasonable for here in Lincoln County, we used Minnehaha County courtrooms as an example, but also did what I think I would call we right-sized them. For instance, almost all of the courtrooms in the Minnehaha County Courthouse are designed to include jury boxes. Now, some of those courtrooms, there is no way in the world you would be able to hold a jury trial in those courtrooms, pre or post-COVID. There's no reason that we need that many courtrooms that are designed to have jury trials. So when we looked at the needs of these two large courtrooms, the medium-sized courtrooms, and the smaller courtrooms, we actually proposed that some of the smaller and even the medium-sized ones here in Lincoln County would not include jury boxes. There's no reason to have them. So I think we really were conscious in deciding what spaces we need. What do we actually need? And we don't need to build jury boxes just to have jury boxes. But we do need courtrooms that are adequate for those types of hearings, whether they're small hearings or hearings in larger cases where you might have six or eight attorneys appearing for different parties. So we've really tried to account for a variety of courtroom sizes in what would be ideal here for Lincoln County.
Judge, I have another question for you or for both of you. This has been a topic where I think a number of commissioners have had the public come up to them. And I think the public would like to hear it from you. But what impact does the unavailability of courtroom space have on the court's docket? And what impact does that have on the litigants?
Well, I guess the for instance is, for example, the trial that'll occur next week in Lincoln County. Obviously, the impact to Lincoln County is it's going to be more expensive. You're going to have to pay transportation for individuals to go to the Minnehaha County Courthouse. So it's a level of expense for the county, but also an inconvenience because the state's attorney's office is going to have to appear in Minnehaha County as opposed to here. Witnesses have been subpoenaed to appear in that courthouse as opposed to this courthouse. It's also very difficult because we do, and I hate to say this out loud, we do quite a bit of hedging our bets in scheduling proceedings. So for instance, there are probably many times in the next couple of months, both for Judge Rasmussen and myself and all of the other judges, where we're double booked. We have two different divorce cases that say they're prepared to go to trial and they're going to go to trial. And my reason and experience tells me that probably one of those cases is going to go away and I will only have to try one of them as opposed to two of them. One of them's going to settle. So if they don't, then we're left in the awkward position that we've told Joe and Jane that their divorce trial is going to happen next week, but we don't have a judge and we don't have a court space. So you can imagine Joe and Jane, who are anxious to be done with one another, can get a little bit out of sorts when we have to reschedule their trial because we don't have the space or a judge. So it can cause huge inconveniences to parties of all sorts when we hedge those bets. But again, we don't have the resources that we need, so that's the only thing that we can do to get the cases moving as efficiently as possible. So we double book, hoping that some of it goes away, but it doesn't always.
I think to tie into that too, on the criminal side, we have double, triple booked hearings and stack weeks for jury trials and things like that. And especially with having people in custody, I think that's an issue. I mean, we know we have to pay to hold them in custody. And if we can't get their case tried due to lack of space or lack of resources, that affects everyone. Just keep that in mind as well, as that's on the back side of things. But attorneys sometimes are prepared to go and sometimes they're not, and things happen. So I think Judge Heilman's right on that we do hedge our bets and think something's going to settle. But there are multiple times yet still this spring where we have four matters that are supposed to go to trial or supposed to have a hearing here in Lincoln County with three courtrooms and only two of them being fairly functional. So it affects a lot of people and obviously their schedules and, like Judge Heilman said, their clients' schedules as well.
Andrew, I'm going to jump a question for you. Oh, excuse me.
We got 37,200 square feet currently net, I think you said. Now, is that... that's our total, or is that the old courthouse?
The 37,200, that's administration. So that's this side of the facility. Yep.
And on the other side, we've got how much?
12,000.
Yep. Okay. If you went to architect school, I'm sure graduated top in your class.
Sure.
You wonder where I'm going. If you waved a magic wand with that building currently existing and we need 8,000 additional square feet, can you find by rearranging that building? This is just an idea. I don't know how you would do this without having a portable courtroom somewhere. But can you find an additional enough space in that courthouse currently across the hallway to accommodate what we need for jury rooms, for clerks, for all of the administration things that go along with the court system? Is it possible to remodel that to accommodate that?
Are you asking the question as if the courtroom spaces that are currently in that building were to be removed, or with the courtrooms?
If you totally redesigned the darn thing, okay? If you redesigned it, can you find enough space in there to accommodate what the court needs presently?
Not with the extra courtrooms that are needed. So, We're trying to, in the space needs assessment, we're trying, and we've had this conversation with John and with some of the department heads. We're trying to not talk about solutions too much and just let's get the numbers so we have, that's the starting point. But it's impossible to not start thinking about solutions. So when I was, some of the thoughts I've had is, the existing courthouse, if there was the potential to do an addition to satisfy courtrooms and support spaces, the existing courthouse structure would more than satisfy the needs for clerk of courts, court services, et cetera, as those spaces would need to grow if you moved, courtroom 2A, courtroom 3A out of that building.
Okay.
But that's moving those, that's taking the more specialized spaces of courtrooms and putting them in a new structure using the existing historic courthouse building as the admin piece.
Okay.
Now, they're depending on layout and things, there would need to be other spaces that would fill that building, because if we moved the courtrooms out and just relied on the expansion of court services and clerk of courts, that building would not be full. But there's also the logistics of how would a new addition tie into that building, and where are there connections and corridors and other things that would eat up some of that space too? So there would need to be a lot more studying of the impacts of those potential options, but that was maybe answers your question. It's just one thought that I've had.
Okay.
because one of the easy ones is courtroom 2A, we've been told, really almost serves no purpose. Mm-hmm. So currently that's square feet, that's 1,000 square feet or so that just sits there. So where you could move some of those other administrative functions into that space, you know, then you're replacing that courtroom as in a new, slightly larger, more functional courtroom.
And Andrew, could you just provide just a little more detail why that courtroom space serves no function? I mean, there's some deficiencies there. Maybe it's worth just illustrating.
I think I'd let Judge Rasmussen elaborate on that, if that's okay.
Sure. I think we had mentioned this before, but both Judge Howman and myself had tried a case in 2A when it was originally built, and there was a jury box in 2A, and the counsel table and the jury box butted up to each other, so you could literally touch the juror. And so we found out very quickly it didn't work for jury trials at all that way. So we removed the jury box and tried to make it more of a technology-friendly courtroom. However, it's just too small. It's space prohibitive to really do anything where you would have more than just two parties. There aren't enough counsel table room to do such hearings where you would have more than two attorneys and one client at each table. It's set up oddly, I guess. I don't know if that's a good way to say it, but we've moved the bench. It's been in two different locations to try to better utilize the space, but it just doesn't work with what we have in there. The other side of it is we do not have a space for the sheriff's office to sit, the courtroom deputy to sit in there. There's no computer or workspace to look up anything. It's not hardwired in for what we would need for it to function as that real time, like Judge Howman said, that real time courtroom experience that we need.
May I ask a question?
Absolutely. Sure.
Would all of this courtroom stuff that's needed go to, is there space to the north of us if that library is moved? I'm talking about to the north, here where the library sits.
Right.
Okay. Well, I'm assuming that can all be worked out.
There is a state statute, Betty, that allows counties to, take the land if they're going to build a courthouse.
Would that
but
be
that
enough room?
But that's the last, that's kind of the ultimate option. There's always room for negotiations and everything between municipal and county entities, of course. But you're correct, that is city-owned land.
Okay. And would all that space that's needed with the courtrooms and everything fit to the north?
I think that's a question for Andrew.
Right.
And I don't know if he's analyzed that or not.
Okay.
That may be.
I bet he has.
If you took the whole rest of this block, mm-hmm. the public park area and the library, yeah, I think there would be plenty of room. So this building is about 19,000 square feet per floor. I talked about 25 or 26,000 square feet of total additional space needed between court system and admin. So net square footage of 25 or 26, that's gross of 32 or 33. So two-story structure of 20,000 square feet. I mean, that or 20,000 square feet per floor, I mean, it could fit. The challenge would be, I don't think that's court system freestanding over there. If court services and clerk of courts are in the old courthouse structure, I mean, there had to be a reshuffling of all of the things in both of these buildings to to come up with the adjacencies and things that would be appropriate, which that's part of, that'd be a huge hurdle to overcome because we'd be upsetting certain departments in this admin building that through the conversations we have with department heads, they're totally fine in the space they're in for the next 10 years and need no growth in footprint. You know, but all of a sudden we'd be having to look at options to be shuffling, doing a major reshuffling of things if there was to be square footage built to the north. That's a quick answer without having put pen to paper to test it, but I'm very certain it would fit. It would just, there's lots of discussions and options to be studied to actually make sure it's functional.
Andrew, can you shoot the picture of the present campus up there?
Yeah.
Please.
Lost. Maybe.
There you go.
Yeah, I mean, you can see it, Betty, right there is, you know, this is about 19,000 square feet. So, I mean, it would almost fit in the park. Now, obviously, you're not going to build a two-story structure right up next to that library, but just the hypothetical question of does it fit, the answer is, yeah, pretty easily, I think.
No, Andrew, when you look at that footprint,
touchy. Breaking things. What do we do, Jake?
Here comes the expert.
Is it?
That's a nice picture.
Yeah,
right there,
isn't that lovely?
That's a.
There.
Okay. You look at this picture, and to meet the needs just currently, I mean, that doesn't look for the future. And if you're spending tax dollars here, where on this campus, and that inside the blue line, is there room for an 8,000 foot, which would currently meet anything? That doesn't louse everything up, because when we look to the north, we really run pretty close to the street. We do have property across the street, but I'm looking within this footprint of the red, or the in the blue line, where is there an option that that this committee or we can consider to look at for future expansion? Are those the trees there? Is that a option there?
So just to reiterate the number, the 8,000, Commissioner Schmidt, was the admin side, and
yeah,
then the 18,000 was the court side. So it's 26 or 32. So
you'd have to go up.
Well, very briefly studied, very, very briefly studied.
I understand.
Steve and I looked at what could you do, what could you, seeing my mouse, no. There we go. We looked at what could you do on the east side of the existing.
Yeah, right there.
In our minds, when people are picturing the historic courthouse structure, they're picturing that southern elevation, you know, the western elevation, or really that view from the intersection from the southwest. And so, you know, the footprint, though, to get, now, when Steve and I were looking at this, at that time, we only had the numbers for the court's needs, which was the 18,000 or so square feet. With the gross, net to gross, you're 25, you know, plus or minus. So if you took that on two stories, it's 12,000, 13,000 square feet per floor. It could fit on the east side. We would project south beyond the face of the original courthouse, mm-hmm. but we could maintain, we wouldn't cover up any of the southern exposure. We would stay on the east side of the structure. But again, that was just quick pulling some dimensions on a site plan just curiosity.
So if we were to go out there, is there space enough there to accommodate what we're looking down the road for 20 years?
That's been my struggle with this, honestly, is could there be a viable project that places a building, respects the historic structure, places a building on the east side and meets the needs for 10 years, 15 years?
Yeah.
I think so. The challenge is if that growth continues at that 7 or 8% that was described, what's the play beyond 20 that. Or 25 yeah. years from now? Because I think to fit that structure on the east side would come a fair ways to the south.
You could meet our immediate needs, perhaps, but in the long range, if you're looking...
That's the challenge. And all of a sudden, if that structure becomes three stories or to satisfy, you know, then it really starts to compete with the historic courthouse, even though it's not physically sitting and blocking that southern exposure, it would just be that much taller. And I think there are aesthetic concerns that would certainly be there.
Okay.
I mean, you could build a third story on that structure of another 12 or 13,000 square feet. Fine. I think there becomes bigger, larger aesthetic considerations at that point. So we have one last comment. We haven't, again, we were trying to just set the baseline and get the numbers. But one obvious thing that helps is if the courtroom 2B would be removed from this building and that 3,100 square feet could go back to use for admin purposes. I mean, that's almost half of the need that's there for admin side growth for the 10-year period. So that makes a big difference. It doesn't satisfy, obviously, there's another 5,000 square feet that needs to be found, but it takes up a big chunk of that square footage need that the admin side has, getting courtroom 2B out of here.
And just so people understand, we have a mixed-use courthouse where you have the general public able to access the, you know, after you come through security, anybody can walk around any portion of the courthouse. And, you know, it's not a closed universe, if you will, like the Minnehaha County system is, where it's just all courtrooms and court space after you walk through security. So maybe is that a nod to that, Andrew, that... Is it a suggestion that courtroom is in the wrong place, or it's situated in such a way where it's not suitable?
We heard two functional concerns, and I'll try to state them correctly, and if I misspeak, please correct me. Two concerns. Number one is sometimes that's used for juvenile court, correct? So the description that Mr. Golden gave of people waiting outside for juvenile court, they're just milling around here next to people trying to get a new license plate, right? So there's no space for them. So that's one of the concerns. The second one is if it's used for a criminal trial, there's no good way to get the inmate in a secure route to that courtroom. I mean, they're coming through the public space. So those were the two biggest concerns. about that courtroom. It's the best functioning courtroom, but it's completely in the wrong spot. So we use that size for testing the square footage of the future large courtrooms.
Is the courtroom that we're discussing 2B, no, 2A or 2B? 2B. Is 2B, that's an example then of what a, when you use the term large courtroom?
Yes.
And just so everybody in their mind's eye can understand what a space would look like, is that, that's what you're talking about?
Yes, I think that courtroom is, from memory, like 2250, 2,250 square feet, and we had the large plugged in at 2,300.
Okay.
So we're right in that ballpark. Just, I quickly looked up, so we had small courtrooms at 1,400 square feet, medium courtrooms at 1,750, and large at 2,300. And so for comparison's sake, 2A, which was deemed too small to be terribly functional, I think is like 947 square feet or something. So, I mean, there's a considerable jump to get up to that functional small courtroom of about 450 square feet.
Anybody else? Is that any, I guess this is the best opportunity any of you might have to ask the judges any questions about what they've presented. We've got the circuit court administrator who's here as well. I mean, any nagging questions or comments or concerns that you'd like to ask?
The first question would be, what impact does technology have on future courts' needs? And maybe that's kind of taking a pure guess as far as square footage is concerned. And then I have a second question, if you can address that one.
Technology is huge, especially since COVID. In fact, in Minnehaha County, we have just wired 8 courtrooms for permanent Zoom installations where we have a great big TV mounted on the screen. The judge can control the Zoom from their computer. But as far as space needs, that doesn't have any impact. Frankly, we haven't done that here because we didn't know what these discussions would lead to, so we didn't invest the sums in doing that. Our courtrooms here do have Zoom capabilities, just not quite as large or as convenient as we do up there. But technology is a part, but it really doesn't impact our space needs.
Thank you. The second question would be, when we're talking about a potential addition to the building, that doesn't really address any of the current functional deficiencies of the existing courthouse at all, correct? Because that's, right now it's deemed pretty inefficient square footage.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah. And that's why it's a little bit of a detailed explanation, but for like, get the numbers right. Like clerk of courts, I mean, they currently have 5 staff and might grow to 10 or 13, but we had a marginal increase in square footage. That's because when we were doing the proposed program, we were taking it more off of looking at it as if it were new square footage, not in the existing space. So our increase was marginal because we feel like if it was new space, it'd be more efficient. Does that make sense? So, yeah, that existing structure is challenging to make accommodate some of those spaces, and then therefore you're less efficient using those spaces.
Andrew, I think you should hit the microphone there because.
Sure. So what I said was, the question was, one more time.
It doesn't address the
inefficiencies
of the existing building.
So our, when we did the existing versus proposed, we did the proposed program of spaces or functions for each of the departments based on kind of rules of thumb if they were to be new spaces, fitting those departments like clerk of courts or court services into the existing building. There's inherently some inefficiencies just because of size of room and limitations of structure and other things. So those had marginal increases in their square footage, even though the staff was maybe doubling. That's because we were assuming new square footage. If they were to stay in the existing, I think like clerk of courts, instead of growing from 23 to 2,900, if that was all square footage in the existing structure, it might end up being 3,500 square feet or something, just because of trying to efficiently lay out people on that existing building is challenging.
And that's exactly where I was going.
Yeah.
Is if we have to put new program space in an existing structure, it's not as efficient, and your numbers might be off a little bit.
And we struggled with that, what the strategy should be, whether we're presenting those as assumed new square footage where we can use benchmarks or rules of thumb for X number of square feet per staff, or if it's, do we do those numbers based on trying to fit it in an inefficient building? You're either skewed too big or too small. The way we did it now is, frankly, we're probably skewed too small, depending on what that ultimate solution is.
Just to dovetail off of that, if you recall from our tour last month, the particular clerk of courts, the space that we're talking about right now, has two vaults in it, where I think if we had that same square footage of space, we certainly wouldn't be utilizing that vault space. But because it is the vault space, we're really limited in the functionality of that, and to change that space, I mean, I can't even fathom what it would take to remove the vaults and make that space functional for what it would need to be.
Or there might be a space over there that they're currently using and there's two people in one larger space. Well, that one larger space is more square footage than you would normally give two people, but to fit a third or a fourth in there doesn't really work either.
And I guess as a follow-up, it's probably, is it more appropriate to kind of have a new square footage column and a remodel square footage column to average it out? Or is it better to just assume that you can create some efficiencies that would take care of the existing building and the new addition together? I think what I'm trying to say is if we go through this exercise and we don't account for inefficiency of remodeled space, we're not really getting everywhere we need to be.
I think we have relative confidence in the numbers based on the information we were provided. Where those numbers still have the potential to fluctuate is based on the solution. Mm-hmm. If the solution was to say, this is not suggesting, this is just a for example. If the solution were to say admin expands into the original courthouse building to satisfy some of their growth, and there's a new courts structure that has all things courts, how does that work and how does that equate to the eventual solution and the square footage needed to do that? That's probably more so the number that we've got now, because we did the proposed programming for some of those, for clerk of courts and court services, assuming efficiencies. And it would add the square footage to those groups if they were not maximized efficiency-wise as putting them in the existing building.
It is possible that the 33,500 square feet could actually become 37 or 38,000 square feet, depending on how it's laid out.
Correct.
Yeah.
I mean, even on the admin side, we were struggling with some of those same things. But we've got a number there now, and it ends up relying on even that 30% square foot or 30% net to gross. You know, how efficiently can we connect an addition? The what we were just discussing on the east side. What inefficiencies does that create? Or what spaces do we chew up in the existing building to connect over and through? You know, none of that's been explored. So I think the 18,000 and change square feet for courts, net square footage of additional need, is a baseline that would likely, that's the floor. And then whatever solutions are proposed, it could increase from there.
There may be other concerns that override some of the efficiencies of connecting a proposed or separate building, correct? I mean, for example, I don't want to use the word efficiency, but the benefit of a self-contained court system, for example. You'd agree it's possible the benefits of that may outweigh any kind of inefficiencies created as a result of that, right?
I think that's a very fair statement.
Okay. Anybody else? I've got 8:49, so we're coming in on our 9 o'clock conclusion time. Anybody else have any questions or comments? Chad, I see you hit the button.
More just a comment. Is the presentation that you gave available, that PowerPoint available either to us online, or could we get, I just would like to be able to sit down with both of them, and I know I have questions. I just need to sit and analyze this stuff before I can formulate a lot of those questions. And your presentation would also help me with that.
You know, Chad, I was probably on 15 or 20 different websites for counties that are either went through this process or going through this process. And almost all of them had presentation materials on their websites. So we'll hang the presentations inside the courthouse improvement tab on our website. Okay, so
I think that would just be really beneficial for referencing.
Who do I need to send that to?
Send that to Jake Oakland. And then if the courts will entertain that as well, if they're okay with that, we'll hang that presentation as well. And then the general public and yourself can take a look at them.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, well, I think we kind of conflated the questions with public comment period, but does anybody have any final or comments they would like to make as part of the comment period before we wrap things up? Okay, I want to thank everyone for their participation here. I will let everybody know that I spoke to the sheriff here earlier. The next meeting that we'll have will be a same discussion as we had tonight, and it will have the Sheriff's Department and the State's Attorney's Office making their pitch, their presentations, if you will. The timing of that has been somewhat dependent upon whether our folks at Architecture Incorporated have the needs assessments done. And so I did speak with Andrew earlier. He believes he could wrap that up in about 2 weeks. Is that correct?
Yeah.
And when I spoke with the sheriff's office, they felt perhaps 3 weeks or so would be appropriate for them. Put their presentations together. Bill, I guess I would ask you, would the state's attorney's office be ready to go same night? Does it need more time? I mean... Yeah. Okay. Well, we'll have Jessica in the state's attorney's office and Bill work on, you know, shooting for some dates approximately 3 weeks from now. So we'll use the same process we've been using. And just so everybody knows, we're going to continue marching down the field with each of the departments. Things will probably start to move a little faster. As you can probably tell, the UJS presentation is, you know, substantial, and it probably deserved even more discussion than what we've given it tonight. And there will be more opportunity for discussion moving forward. But we'll have the sheriff's office, we'll have state's attorney's office next month here, and then we'll continue to move on with the other administrative departments, and then we'll move into another phase of these meetings after we get through them. So if nobody has any alibis, I will we'll adjourn. Thank you.